Good evening, everyone. Welcome to First United Methodist Church of North Hollywood and our Christmas Eve service. We are so grateful to see all of your lovely faces here tonight to celebrate the risen Savior. We're really looking forward to sharing this contemplative worship with you and serve communion and share in that together. So let's start this evening's worship service. If you are able, please rise, open your red hymnals to number 240, and we will begin by singing joyfully, Hark the Herald Angels Sing.
Whose hope was in the Word made flesh, and with whom in the Lord Jesus we are one forevermore. We humbly offer these prayers and praises up to heaven through the one who entered our world so long ago, Jesus the Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, almighty and loving God, and all of God's people said, Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Like the shepherds of Bethlehem and the wise men from the east, we too travel to the manger tonight to worship. The first Advent candle reminded us of hope. As God traveled with Mary and Joseph, he traveled with us, giving us hope. The second candle tells us that Jesus came to us with peace. Jesus comes to the world as the Prince of Peace. The third candle reminds us of love, the love of friendship, the love of family, and the love of God. And the fourth candle represents joy, the joy that was brought to the world the night our Savior was born.
Tonight we come and light the final candle in our Advent wreath, the Christ candle. The Christ candle is a call to service. The love we have for God is not a mature love unless it causes us to want to help others. Jesus' life was one of helpfulness and of service to others. This is the giving part of Christmas. Let us light the Christ candle as our promise of a life of helpfulness to others.
The scripture tonight is Matthew 2:9-11. And so they left on their way. They saw the same star they had seen in the east. When they saw it, how happy they were. What joy was theirs. It went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. They went into the house, and when they saw the child with his mother, they knelt down and worshipped him. They brought their gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh, and presented him to him. Please pray with us. Our Father, who has given us the gift of his own Son, let us be thinking now and all the rest of our lives and how we can give. Let our love for thee be so great that it bubbles over into the love of all your children. Amen.
Please open your red hymnals now to number 242, Love Came Down at Christmas.
Oh,
first lesson comes from the book of Isaiah, chapter 9, verses 2, 6 through 7. We understand darkness. We know it's supposed to be avoided except when we sleep. We fill it with light so we do not have to live with the dark. But there is another darkness our lamps and lights have no effect on. The darkness of despair, oppression, and depression can become places we find ourselves trapped in. In this darkness, hope has disappeared. The prophet Isaiah announces the birth of a king to a people in this kind of darkness. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in the land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness. From this time onward and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this.
The prophet Micah builds on Isaiah's divine promise of a king.
This king will usher in a reign of justice for the poor and peace for all of God's creation. But you, O Bethlehem of Ephrathah, you are one of the little clans of Judah. From you shall come forth from me one who is to rule in Israel, whose origin is from of old, from ancient days. Therefore he shall give them up until the end time, until the time when she who is in labor has brought forth. Then the rest of his kindred shall return to the people of Israel, and he shall stand and feed his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they shall live secure, for now he shall be great to the ends of the earth, and he shall be the one of peace. And now would you please return to the red hymnal, and we will stand and sing hymn 230, O Little Town of Bethlehem.
But she was much perplexed by his words I pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I am a virgin?" The angel said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God." Then Mary said, "Here I am, the servant of the Lord. Let it be with me according to your word." Then the angel departed from her.
Will you pray with me? Holy God, we greet you on this holiest of nights, this time when we gather in special spaces to remember the way that you invaded our realm, how the creator of the universe would be emptied into the form of a small, vulnerable, dependent baby. Of all the peril that you undertook of the pregnancy with Mary and the journey to Bethlehem. And we remember where you were born. Not in a palace, not in a temple, but in a place where the animals were kept. So for all of the divine beauty that we seek to emulate, Lord, you chose to be born in humble estate. And Lord, as people who come before you and come and kneel and visit you year after year at the manger, how often we aspire to be great. How we aspire to be noteworthy. How we aspire for power and influence, for riches and for wealth. At this year, Lord, we pray that we would emulate you. Take on humility to understand that our very lives and our very selves are meant to be given away. Meant to be given away to help peace and joy and love and mercy and compassion and goodness and kindness to see these things manifest in the world around us, in our lives, in our actions. And that, Lord, somehow together we might make a difference. So that the things that happen here on earth would be the same as happens in the heavens. So Lord, this Christmas, we pray that you would be born in us. That you would make your home within us. And that in doing so, we might be shaped a little more into your image. To do your work, to fulfill your will. Tonight, Lord, this is our prayers as we prepare ourselves to come and receive communion. All the mercy and compassion, Lord, poured over us so that our houses would be clean to receive you again. So, Lord, in the name the child we celebrate tonight, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, we offer these prayers to you. And all of God's people said,
Our fourth lesson comes from Luke. After a long and comfortable journey and against a backdrop of emperors and taxes, Jesus is born. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was a descendant from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn.
And suddenly, there was an angel with the angel, a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary, Joseph, and the child lying in the manger.
And Mary is deep in her pregnancy, and they are tired from their 85-mile walk into Bethlehem. Fortunately for them, someone, and we don't know who, takes pity upon them and allows them to come and sleep in the place where they keep their animals. Now, it may not have been the most ideal place to stay, but for a woman who's ready to give birth, well, it's better than being outside and being exposed to the elements of the evening. But it is here in this space, a space meant for the animals, that Mary gives birth to her baby son, Jesus. And Mary takes her new baby boy and wraps him in swaddling clothes and lays him down in the only place that is there that will hold a baby. It's the feeding trough, there in the center of the space. And some people will argue whether it was wooden or stone, and personally, I don't care. It doesn't matter to me. Because this year, as I've been thinking about the Nativity, and as preachers, we think about it every year, and we always wonder, what are we going to bring out about the Nativity again this year? This will be my, I've been doing this for 20 years now. And this year, as I sat with the story, what struck me was the manger. And really, what struck me was what the manger isn't. It isn't a crib, it isn't a bed, it isn't a throne. The manger isn't in a palace, and it's not in a temple, it's not in a church. It's not richly decorated. It's not made of gold. And it isn't upholstered, and it isn't made up with the finest of Egyptian cotton sheets, nor the warmest, softest blankets. It's a feeding trough. And the prophets, they promised a king, one that would be born in Bethlehem. But we look at the child lying in a manger and we have to ask, what kind of king do we have here? And when we ask that question, the answer begins to get a little stranger when we consider who the birth announcements get sent out to. The shepherds out in the field. Shepherds were not seen as being the finest representation of first century Palestinian society. They were seen as poor, as shifty, as unclean. They were often resented because they would let their animals graze on their neighbors' properties. But they were tolerated, but they were never esteemed by others in the population. So the shepherds are out in the field, maybe gathered around a fire telling stories. They're not dignitaries, they're not ambassadors, they're not high-ranking government officials. They're not wealthy, they are not influential. They are not educated, and they aren't temple-going people or synagogue-going people. They were not the priestly elite. They were simply shepherds. And they were the ones who heard the announcement first. And not only that, but they were the first ones to be given a charge. They were given the announcement that Christ was born. And then they were told to go and see. And then they were sent to tell everybody that Christ had been born. So this is the announcement, this is the birth that we celebrate. And the question comes back, who do we celebrate? What kind of king would engage in such grassroots strategy? What kind of God would choose to be born in such a rustic place? What kind of season are we really in the midst of? So we set up our nativity sets. We look at the Holy Family and the animals that surround them. I happen to love nativity sets, just like my mom. But you look at it, you think it's beautiful, it's angelic, it's sweet. But there's so much more to the story. arrive in the center of that nativity, right in that feeding trough, is a Savior who is Christ the Lord. And yes, he is a king, but he would later say, his kingdom is not of this world. And yes, he is a God incarnate, but he's a shepherd God who is here to find all the lost sheep, to bind up the wounded, to care for the overlooked. A shepherd God who will give up his life for the sake of the sheep. This is why he's laying in the manger in the center of your nativity sets. And it gets even more interesting as we prepare ourselves to celebrate Holy Communion. For this baby will grow up, learn the trade of his father, and then he will go out and be a wandering rabbi, a teacher, a prophet. And one day when he is teaching his people, he will say, "Behold, I am the bread of life. I am the bread of life come down from heaven." And as we kneel down at the manger alongside the shepherds, we can imagine the animals coming in and poking in and seeing what's there as well. Let us consider what it means that this Christ, this vulnerable, dependent baby, what it means that he is laying in a food trough. May we think about what kind of Savior, what kind of King, what kind of God is he? As we come to take communion, as we share bread, and as we share a cup, may we consider what it means to take this Jesus into our hearts, into our lives, into our minds, and how it should shape us, and what it might call us to do and to be in the world around us. For just as the Savior gives his life, so we give our lives as well. So that a kingdom that is not of this world will be made real within this one. This is what Christmas is about. It's a bottom-up movement of God's grace that we are called to be a part of. And it is a God that is here to reconcile people back to himself. Pour out grace and mercy and forgiveness, but also to call us to do something and be something. This Christmas, may we be what Christ calls us to be. And may as we kneel in that nativity, may we consider what kind of King, what kind of Savior, what kind of God. And we'll get to do that in just a moment here. As we come to the table, here in the United Methodist Church, we have an open table, which means that everybody is welcome to come and receive. The only thing we ask, the only thing that is required, is that you desire to participate, that you desire to come and receive these gifts of bread and of wine. We are going to be going through an ancient liturgy called the Great Thanksgiving. And you can find it in your red hymnals on page 13 under the heading of the Great Thanksgiving. I invite you to take those out, open them up, and join with me. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing to give thanks to you, Almighty God, creator of the heavens and the earth. You created light out of darkness, and you brought forth life on the earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. And when we turned away from you and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets. In the fullness of time, you gave your only Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Savior. At his birth, the angels sang, "Glory to you in the highest, and peace to all your people on earth." And so, with your people on earth and with all the company of heaven, we praise your name, and we join in their unending hymn.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Mary and Joseph went from Galilee to Bethlehem and found no room. And in the same way, Jesus went from Galilee to Jerusalem and was despised and rejected. Jesus was born in the poverty of a stable. And in the same way, by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church and delivered us from our slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and by your Spirit. In the same way, your word became flesh on that night so long ago. On another night, he gave himself up for us. We remember that he took bread, that he gave thanks, and he broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, and he gave thanks to you. And he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take, drink from this, all of you. This is my blood, the cup of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sin. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's suffering for us as we proclaim the mystery of our faith.
Christ has died.
Christ is risen.
Christ will come again.
Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us gathered here, and into these gifts of bread and juice. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at the heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with your Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever and ever and unto the ages. And all of God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. Now with the confidence that comes from being children of God, let us join together in the prayer that Christ taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Will those who are helping me and distributing the elements please come forward at this time? Because there is one loaf, we who are many are one body. For we all partake of the one loaf, and the loaf which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. And in the same way, the cup which we share is a sharing in the blood of Christ. And it gives us life, and it makes us family. others stand at the rail, we will be giving you a piece of bread. You can dip it in the cup. You may stay and pray at the rail if you so desire, or you may return to your seat, but please come and receive the free gifts of God. All are welcome. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. Fill us with your light and your love, that we may shine in the darkness and not be overcome by it. Keep us shining through the fire of your Spirit, so that we might incarnate your presence every day. In the name of Christ our Lord. Amen. Our final reading tonight comes from John chapter 1, verses 1 through 14. And to open up his gospel, John unfolds the mystery of the incarnation. He plays with light and with dark and with life. Hear now the word of the Lord. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and all things came into being through him, and without him not one thing came into being. What has come into being in him was life, and the life was the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John, and he came as a witness to testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light, but he came to testify to the light. The true light, which enlightens everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world came into being through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to what was his own, and his own people did not accept him. But to all who received him, who believed in his name, he gave power to become children of God, who were born not of blood or of the will of the flesh or of the will of man, but were born of God. And the Word became flesh and lived among us, and we have seen his glory. The glory is of a Father's only Son, full of grace and full of truth. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. That interplay of light shining in the darkness, and the darkness not overcoming it, becomes a very important and central image as we celebrate Christmas. In just a moment, we are going to pass the Christ light among all of us who have gathered here. If you don't have a candle, they are in the back. And I will be coming down the center aisle and lighting here along the aisle, and then we will pass it. And you need to remember that when a candle is lit, it needs to stay vertical. We tilt the unlit candle to receive the flame from the other. And to please be careful. You don't want to spill any wax on ourselves or on the carpet. But in that scripture, we hear about John, who came, who wasn't the light, but he testified to the light, so that others might be able to see it and recognize it and receive it. In a way, that's our job. As we have received Christ, as we are celebrating his birth, it's our job to point and testify, to spread and to shine the light that Christ puts within us. This is the verse that Martin Luther King got his inspiration to say that you cannot drive hate out with hate, but only with love. Or it's the same way that you cannot chase out darkness with more darkness, but with a single light, the dark begins to recede. Receive the light of Christ, that child born and laid in a manger, and let's shine it and spread it, because this world could use a little more light. We're going to be singing a song that is celebrating its 200th anniversary, a simple song written because an organ was broken and they needed a simple song that could be played on guitar and shared in the chapel. Silent Night, Holy Night. And there is a little slip of paper in your bulletin so you don't have to hold the whole hymnal. Let us join together. Let's stand and join together. Our hearts and our voices.
Oh,
So, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
We do hope that the light that we see and the light that we shine is something that pushes the darkness away. And in just a moment, we'll be going forth from this place. We'll have time with family. Tomorrow's a big day. But as we go, I hope you'll remember this moment of peace, where our candles are lit and Christ is here. I want you to go with peace and with love, with the power to shine Christ's light. And we're going to sing that first verse together one more time. Hey, you got it, Roger?
Yes.